never find another lover more precious than you. More precious than you.
Greetings. Welcome to another episode of Israel Scripture TV. I am Apostle Malachi P.L. Reynolds, and I want to come to you today with a subject entitled Marriage and Sex. Marriage and Sex. Before I go any further, I want to let you know that when I teach or when I say the name of God, I usually also mention it in Paleo Hebrew, Yah. Or when I say the name Jesus, I usually mention it also in Paleo Hebrew, pronounced by me as Yahawasha or by some others as Yahusha. And I am the pastor of Lost Found Israelites Congregation right here in Fort Worth, Texas. And today I'm going to speak with you briefly about marriage and sex. It's a very controversial issue living in this culture today in America. But first of all, I want to define to you from the Bible that marriage that involves sex is between a man and a woman. Marriage defined by the Bible, a romantic marriage that is between a man and a woman. So we're going to get into just a few scriptures. So get your Bibles out, your pen out, and your pad. And I'm just going to go over just about four scriptures from four chapters in the Bible. Let's turn our attention first to the Gospel of Mark, the 10th chapter, the 2nd verse. That's the Gospel of Mark, the 10th chapter, the 2nd through the 9th verse. And it reads, "And the Pharisees came to him," that is Yahawasha, whom the world called Jesus, "and asked him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife, tempting him?" So the Pharisees came to him, not because they had a sincere question about what they was asking, not because they had a sincere desire for an answer about the question that they was answering Yahawasha, whom the world called Jesus. They came to him, the Pharisees came to him to tempt him, to try to find a fault in him so that they could have him put to death. The Gospel of Mark, 10th chapter, the 3rd verse. "And he answered and said unto them," after they asked him, "Is it lawful for a man to put away his wife?" He said, "What did Moses command you?" The 4th verse. "And they said, Moses suffered to write a bill of divorcement," or allowed to write a bill of divorcement, "and to put her away." The 5th verse. "And Yahawasha answered and said unto them, for the hardness of your heart, he wrote you this precept." 6th verse. "But from the beginning of the creation, God," or Yahawah, "made them male and female." That is to say that marriage is between a male and a female, a man and a woman, and no law or decree that is passed by the United States government or by the judicial system of the United States can redefine marriage, because marriage is an absolute truth. It is between a man and a woman. An absolute truth is something that is the truth always. It doesn't change. So Yahawasha answered and said unto them, "For the hardness of your heart," that is, "that Moses wrote you this precept." 6th verse. "But from the beginning of the creation, God," or Yahawah, "made them male and female," that is, man and woman. 7th verse. "For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife." 8th verse. "And they two shall be one flesh," or shall be made one flesh. So then they are no more two, but one flesh. The 9th verse. What therefore had God or Yahweh had joined together, let not man put asunder, or let not man separate. Now, Yahweh Shah, whom the world called Jesus, is defining marriage in this conversation that he's having with the Pharisees as between a man and a woman, a male and a female. And he's saying that marriage is when two people come together and they become one flesh. Now, I know the question they was asking him was about a divorce, but I'm not going to touch on that right now. I'm going to touch on about marriage and sex. What is marriage? And how can two be made one flesh? So, Yahweh Shah, whom the world called Jesus, defined marriage as between a man and a woman. And he said, also in one of these verses, he said that, and the two, the man and the woman, shall become one flesh. How does a man and a woman become one flesh? Let's turn our attention to Genesis, the 7th chapter. No, excuse me, Genesis, the 2nd chapter. Genesis, the 2nd chapter. And I'm going to start reading from the 7th verse, and then I'm going to drop down to the 18th verse. Turn your attention to Genesis, the 2nd chapter, the 7th verse, and it reads, "And Yahweh, or Elohim, formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Drop down in the same chapter of Genesis, the 7th chapter, the 18th verse. So we see in this Genesis, the 2nd chapter, the 7th verse, that Yahweh made man. And Yahweh made man. He did not make anything else but man. So what makes a man? A job don't make a man. Clothes don't make a man. A car, a jewelry don't make a man. But what makes a man is Yahweh makes man. Genesis, the 2nd chapter, let's drop down to the 18th verse. And it reads, "And Yahweh said," or Elohim said, "it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him and help meet for him." Now, let's drop down to the 19th verse. And I'm going to read from the 19th verse through the 25th verse in the same chapter, Genesis, the 2nd chapter. And it reads, "And out of the ground, Yahweh or Elohim formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and to the fowl of the air and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an helpmeet for him." The 21st verse reads, "And Yahweh, Yah Elohim, caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs," that is Yahweh, Elohim, "took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof." The 22nd verse, "And the rib which Elohim had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said," the 23rd verse, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man will leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So we see that in the Gospel of Mark, the 10th chapter, the 2nd through the 9th verse, when Yahawashah, or Jesus, was speaking to the Pharisees, he was quoting from Genesis when he said, but from the beginning. What about from the beginning? Well, from the beginning, Elohim, Yahweh, made male and female, man and woman. And I want to let you know, my brothers and sisters, that in Genesis, the 2nd chapter, we have the first marriage being performed. And the first marriage that was performed in the earth was by God, or was by Yahweh, bringing Adam and Eve together. And listen, Adam named every fowl of the air and every creature of the earth. And when Yahweh brought him Eve, he named her woman, for she was taken from his rib, and she was of his flesh and of his bones. Okay? But I want to let you know that when they came together, they became one flesh. How did they become one flesh? Well, one thing we know, that when they came together, when Adam had Eve brought to him by God or Yahweh, there was a marriage right there being performed by the Most High. But how did they become one flesh? What is the definition of true marriage? Does a marriage certificate down at the local municipal court building, does that define what marriage is? I'm not discouraging you, brothers and sisters, from getting a marriage certificate. I do encourage you to get one for legal purposes, but I want to let you know, my brothers and sisters, paper does not define what a true marriage is. Neither does a ring define what a true marriage is. We have to get beyond our emotions and focus on what the scripture says. Because in the first wedding that was performed, there was no ring. There was no paper certificate. But when Yahweh brought Eve unto Adam, let's find out, how was that marriage made a marriage? Okay, let's go to 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter. In the New Testament, 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, and around the 13th verse. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, now we have defined what marriage is, or who or what it consists of. We have defined that marriage consists of a man and a woman, a male and a female, a romantic marriage. A marriage does not consist of a man and a man. That's an abomination, according to the Bible. A marriage does not consist of between a woman and a woman. That's an abomination, according to the Bible. But marriage, according to the Bible, and from the beginning, consists of a male and a female, a man and a woman, a God-made man and a God-made woman. Not a transgender, but between a God-made man and a God-made woman. Now let's find out. We have already answered what marriage is, or who does it consist of. It consists of a male and a female, a man and a woman. Now let's find out, how does two be made one flesh? Yahawashah, whom the world called Jesus, said unto the Pharisees, that the two shall be made one. How does two people, a male and a female, become one flesh, one body? Let's turn to 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter. I'm going to start reading from the 13th verse. And it reads, meats for the belly, and the belly for meats. But Yahweh, our God, shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is for fornication, but for Yahweh, and Yahweh for the body. Now I want to let you know that the word fornication is really a Greek word or a Greek term, because in Exodus, the 20th chapter, it doesn't say thou shalt not fornicate. It says thou shalt not commit adultery. And I'll explain that a little further later. The 16th verse in 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, reads, and God, or Yahweh, had both raised up the most Yahalashah, and will also raise up us by his own power. Know ye not, 15th verse, that your bodies are the members of Hamashiach, or Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of an harlot or a whore? Question. God forbid, or Yahweh forbid. 16th verse. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to an harlot, or a whore, is one body? Question. For two, said he, shall be made one flesh. For two, said he, shall be made uno, which is one for Spanish. For two shall be made one flesh. 17th verse. But he that is joined unto Yahalashah is one ruach, or one spirit. 18th verse. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man do it is without the body. But he that committed fornication sinned against his own body. Now listen. Now, there was a circumstance going on in the church of Corinth, which the Apostle Paul was led to write this epistle or letter to the church of Corinth. And he's mentioning these verses that I just read. But what I want to do is point to you and highlight to you about how two are made one flesh. Well, he just said that when a man have sex with a woman, that's how two are made one flesh. When a man has sex with a woman, two are made one flesh. Now listen, sex, whoever you have sex with, my brother, you actually became one flesh with them. My sister, daughter of Zion, whatever man you have sex with, you become one flesh with them. So when you become one flesh, it's the result of you, my brother, are having sex with a woman, or it's the result of you, my sister, having sex with a man. And Yahawashah said that, and when the male and female come together, they both shall become one. They should be made one flesh. So we can conclude that sex is marriage. Sex is marriage. Sex is marriage in the sense that when two people come together, when a man and woman come together and they have intimacy, or they copulate with one another, when they have sex, that is defined as one flesh. How else can you become one flesh? Paul is saying in the 6th chapter of 1 Corinthians that if you as a man take your body and have sex with a woman, brother, you married that woman because you have become one flesh with them. Likewise, you sisters, If you go and have sex with a man, you have become married to that man. I know this is unpopular because the Bible, when it's taught right, is unpopular in this American culture. So does sex make marriage? Sex makes two become one flesh. And according to the scriptures, sex does make marriage. But the problem is that a lot of people are having uncommitted, sexual relationships with people that they don't intend to be married to. Let me say it again, brothers and sisters. The problem is that people are having uncommitted sexual relationships with people who they don't intend or never intended to be in a long relationship with. You never intended to marry or to be in a long relationship with the one you've had sex with. But I want to let you know that, listen, this is why a lot of people have issues in relationships, because sex is not just carnal. Sex is also spiritual. So the guy, sisters, that you had sex with the last year or the last several months, you will find yourself still connected to that guy, even though you're in another relationship 7 months or a year later. Likewise, for the brothers as well. The woman you had sex with last year or several months ago, you will find yourself somewhat still connected to that lady you had sex with a year or several months ago. And this is why we need to be careful. This is why the Bible stresses a lot about women being virtuous women, having discipline over your sexual organs. Likewise, for you brothers, the Bible stresses that we are to be holy. Women, you are not to be whores and harlots. Brothers, you are not to be whoremongers. You understand? So listen, you can have the ring. You can have the expensive wedding ceremony. You can have said the marriage vows, but none of that makes true marriage. You understand? And see, another reason why a lot of people are having marital problems is because the one who you had sex with and married, you understand? Y'all don't share the same views. Y'all don't share the same faith. The Bible says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And the problem is that we have believers having sex and getting married to unbelievers. That's another problem. So I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, with this last verse. Hebrews, the 13th chapter, the 4th verse. Hebrews, the 13th chapter, the 4th verse. I'm not discouraging you from getting a marriage certificate. I'm not discouraging you from getting a ring and things like that. But I just want to let you know that what makes true marriage is allowing yourself, first of all, to be in right standing with the Most High and allowing Him to lead you to the right person. Because Yahawashi, when the world called Jesus, He did tell Him in the Gospel of Mark, the 10th chapter, what Yah has put together, let no man separate. And the reason why a lot of marriages don't last is because Yah or Yahweh never put them together. Mankind put them together. Or your lust put you together with that person. Because a lot of what's going on in American culture today, there's a lot of people, you understand, they are having sexual affairs and marrying one another, you understand, out of lust, not because of that woman or that man is a believer. And the result of all this uncommitted sexual marriage is a lot of fatherless children, especially in the black community, a lot of fatherless children. You understand? But Hebrews, the 13th chapter, the 4th verse says, marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. Marriage is honorable, and the bed is undefiled. In the Old Testament, it was biblical for a woman to be given away by her father as a virgin. But I want you to know that if you're not a virgin, you can repent of your sins, and the Most High will purify you, daughters of Zion, by the blood of Jesus, or by the